So friends, we are discussing the OSCE of the chest x-ray. So this is another OSCE. You can see, describe this x-ray. The examiner can ask the question, please describe this x-ray. Then what will you say? You will say, this is a PA view of the chest x-ray. Oh, I am describing the chest x-ray. So you will say, this is the PA view of the chest x-ray taken in erect posture, which shows a horizontal fluid level. It is showing a horizontal fluid level on the right side. It is showing the horizontal fluid level on the right side. There is increased translucency above the horizontal level. There is increased translucency above the horizontal level, which is lacking in lung markings. It is lacking in lung markings. There is increased translucency above the horizontal level and which is lacking in lung markings. That is the pneumo component. This is the pneumo component. Pneumo component. And a homogeneous opacity is seen below the horizontal level. Below the horizontal level, a homogeneous opacity is seen, which is the horizontal component. This is hydro component, not horizontal. It is the hydro component. The homogeneous opacity, that is the hydro component, is uniform, and medially it has merged with cardiac Schlhout. The homogeneous opacity is uniform and medially it merges with the cardiac Schlhout. The trachea and the cardiac shadows are shifted towards the left side. The trachea and the cardiac shadow are shifted towards the left side. The left-sided costophrenic angle and the left lung shows no apparent abnormality. Other points are within the normal range. So how will you describe the chest x-ray of the hydropneumothorax? You will see this is a PA view of the chest taken in erect posture, which shows a horizontal fluid level on the right chest. There is increased translucency above the horizontal fluid level, which is lacking in lung markings. That is the pneumo component. And a homogeneous opacity is seen below the horizontal level, that is the hydro component. The homogeneous opacity, that is the hydro component, is uniform and medially it has merged with the cardiac Schlhout. Trachea and the cardiac shadow are shifted towards the left side, and the left side cardiac phrenic angle and the left lung shows no apparent abnormality. Other points are within the normal limit. So in this way you will describe the chest x-ray. I will again repeat, this is the PA view of the chest. You will see this is a PA view of the chest with horizontal fluid level on the right side. There is increased translucency above the horizontal fluid level, which is lacking in lung markings, and it forms a pneumo component. And below the horizontal level, there is homogeneous uniform opacity, and it forms the hydro component. The homogeneous opacity merges with the right cardiac border, and the cardiac and the trachea is shifted towards the opposite side. Other lung is within normal limit, and the costophrenic angle is also normal on the other side. So in this way you will describe the hydropneumothorax chest x-ray. So what is your conclusion? It is a right-sided hydropneumothorax, right-sided hydropneumothorax. So it is a right-sided hydropneumothorax. The x-ray of the picture of hydropneumothorax should always be taken in erect posture. So this x-ray should always be taken of a case of hydropneumothorax should always be taken in erect posture. Then can you locate the collapsed lung, left lung? So can you locate the examiner can ask the question, can you locate the collapsed left lung? Then you will say no, it is usually hidden within the fluid and is not visible in the x-ray. So you will say it is usually hidden within the fluid and is not visible on the x-ray. Can you locate the collapsed? I think it should be collapsed right lung. Then you will say it is hidden within the fluid and is not visible on the chest X-ray. Then what are the cardinal features of hydropneumothorax? This is very, very important. Cardinal features of hydropneumothorax. So what are the cardinal features of hydropneumothorax? I am writing here the cardinal feature 1, 2, and 3. There are three cardinal features of hydropneumothorax. Cardinal features of hydropneumothorax. What are those? This is the cardinal feature, are the presence of shifting dullness. The presence of shifting dullness. Shifting dullness. Then succussion splash. Succussion splash. Then lastly, horizontal fluid level. Horizontal fluid level. Horizontal fluid level. So these are the three cardinal features of hydropneumothorax. That is the shifting dullness, succussion splash, horizontal fluid level. These are the three cardinal features of hydropneumothorax. Shifting dullness, succussion splash, and horizontal fluid level. Then what are the differential diagnoses of hydropneumothorax? Very important question. What are differential diagnoses of this chest X-ray? Then you will say the differential diagnosis of hydropneumothorax, it could be pyo or hemopneumothorax. It could be pyo or hemopneumothorax. It could be pyo or hemopneumothorax. It could be pus or blood with air. So pyo or hemopneumothorax can be the differentials. Then infected lung cyst could be the differentials. Infected lung cyst. Infected lung cyst could be the differential. Then very big lung abscess. Very big lung abscess. Very big lung abscess. So what are the differential of hydropneumothorax? It could be pyo or hemopneumothorax. It could be infected lung cyst, or it could be very big lung abscess, you can say. Multiple air fluid level in the lung suggest multiple lung abscess or loculated hydropneumothorax. So multiple air fluid level in the lung suggest multiple lung abscess or loculated hydropneumothorax. So it was the case of hydropneumothorax. We have done with it. So differential, remember, pyo or hemopneumothorax, infected lung cyst, very big lung abscess. Then we'll discuss, this is another X-ray. This is a X-ray of emphysema. Then the question comes, describe this X-ray. Now how will you describe? You will again say this is PA view of the chest, which shows, this is a PA view of the chest, which shows hypertranslucency. Hypertranslucency above the lung fields, above the lung field there is hypertranslucency, and you can see the white intercostal spaces with horizontal ribs, with wide intercostal spaces with horizontal ribs. Then low flat diaphragm, narrow vertical heart, teardrop heart or tubular heart, teardrop heart or tubular heart, large and prominent hilar shadows, large and prominent hilar shadows with diminished peripheral vascular pattern. Few villi are seen as rounded areas with increased translucency, with thin hairline shadow forming the walls. So you will say there is no mediastinal shift. Other points are within normal limit. Emphysema is the permanent overinflation of the airspace in the lung, which is distal to the terminal respiratory bronchioles, as well as destruction of the alveolar septa. So what is emphysema? Emphysema is the permanent dilatation of the airspace is distal to the terminal respiratory bronchiole, as well as destruction of the alveolar septa. So this is the definition of emphysema. So we are discussing the elaborating the X-ray of emphysema. So you will say this is a PA view of the chest X-ray showing the hypertranslucency of both the lung fields, hypertranslucency of both the lung fields with wide intercostal spaces, with wide intercostal spaces, with horizontal ribs, with low flat diaphragm, and narrow vertical heart, narrow vertical heart, teardrop heart or tubular heart, large and prominent hilar shadows, large and prominent hilar shadows, large and prominent hilar shadows with decreased peripheral vascular patterns, with decreased peripheral vascular pattern. Few bullae are seen as round pasties, few bullae are seen as round pasties, few bullae are seen as round pasties, few bullae are seen as round areas of increased translucency. It is not opacity. Few bullae are seen as rounded areas of increased translucency. Rounded areas of increased translucency. Rounded areas of increased translucency. Few bullae are seen as rounded area of increased translucency with thin hairline shadow forming the walls. With thin hairline shadow forming the walls. With thin hairline shadows forming the walls. With thin hairline shadows forming the wall. With thin hairline shadows forming the wall. There is no mediastinal shift. No mediastinal shift. Other points are within normal limit. So describe this X-ray. This is a PA view of the chest X-ray showing the bilateral hyperinflated lung fields, translucent increased intercostal spaces, horizontal ribs, then flat diaphragm, then tubular heart, and perihilar shadows with no mediastinal shift. Few bullae are seen as round areas, few bullae are seen as round areas. So in this way you will describe the chest X-ray of the emphysema. Then what is your conclusion? So you will say it is bullous emphysema. Conclusion is, it is a case of bullous emphysema. Then the question comes, examiner can ask, what are the causes of bilateral hypertranslucency in a chest X-ray? Tell me the cause of bilateral increased translucency in chest X-ray. So you will say emphysema first of all, then you will say if it is bilateral, pneumothorax. First is emphysema. Then second is you will say bilateral pneumothorax. Bilateral pneumothorax. Then you will say bilateral pneumothorax. Then you will say multiple bulla, bronchial asthma. Then you third is multiple bulla. Then fourth is bronchial asthma. Then fifth is over inflammation, over exposed film or over penetrated film. And last is Fallot's teratology with pulmonary atresia and Epstein anomaly. Fallot's teratology with pulmonary atresia and last is Epstein anomaly. So what are the causes of bilateral hyperinflated lung fields? So you underline it with me. First is emphysema. We have discussed it. First is emphysema. Then is bilateral pneumothorax can cause bilateral hypertranslucency. Similarly, multiple bullae can form bilateral translucency. Bronchial asthma can form bilateral translucency. Then over penetrating or overexposed film can present as bilateral hypertranslucency. Then Fallot's teratology with pulmonary atresia and Epstein anomaly. So these are the causes of bilateral hypertranslucency lung field as emphysema, bilateral pneumothorax, multiple bullae, bronchial asthma, over penetrated film, Fallot's teratology with pulmonary atresia and Epstein anomaly. Then comes the question examiner can ask, can you what are bullae? Then you will say bullae are thin walled, less than 1 mm thickness air spaces, more than 1 cm in diameter, produced by the rupture of the alveolar walls. Bullae are usually situated subpleurally and may be single or multiple, large or small. Rupture of the bullae give rise to the pneumothorax. So what are bullae? So you will say these are the thin walled air spaces having a thickness of, so bullae are, what are bullae? So bullae are thin walled spaces of less than 1 mm, less than 1 mm, less than 1 mm thickness, less than 1 mm thickness, less than 1 mm thickness, and having a diameter of more than 1 cm. These are basically the air spaces, thin walled air spaces, having the thickness of less than 1 mm and diameter of more than 1 cm, more than 1 cm diameter, and thickness is less than 1 mm, produced by the rupture of the alveolar walls. Bullae are usually situated subpleurally and can be single or multiple, large or small. Rupture of bullae gives rise to the pneumothorax. Then what is petit heart, tubular heart, teardrop heart? Long and tubular heart is found in the PAV of the chest x-ray, in emphysema, Addison disease, pan hypopituitarism, and constrictive pericarditis. So this is very important. You can what are the causes of tubular heart? Examiner can ask, what are the causes of tubular heart? Tubular heart is also called as the petit heart, or it can called as the teardrop heart. Petit heart or teardrop heart. So the causes for this is, first we are discussing is the emphysema. Emphysema can cause tubular heart. Then Addison disease. Then pan hypopituitarism. Then fourth is constrictive pericarditis. So EAPC, emphysema, Addison disease, pan hypopituitarism, and constrictive pericarditis. These are the causes of tubular heart shadow. So this was about the emphysema. Now we'll discuss another important entity of chest x-ray for OSCE, and this is bronchiectasis. So we'll discuss now the bronchiectasis in detail. So the examiner asks you in OSCE, describe this chest x-ray, describe it. Then you will say, this is a PA view of the chest. So you will say, this is PA view of the chest, showing multiple ring shadows at both the lower zones, at both the lower zones, showing the multiple ring shadows, more on the left side than on the right side, more on the left side than on the right side. Then areas of haziness or fibrosis is seen at the bases. The area of fibrosis and haziness is seen at the bases. There is big bulla seen in the right apex. Then right costophrenic angle is blunted. And there is no mediastinal shift. Other points are within normal limit. Then more things is that dilated bronchi give rise to the tram line shadows, linear streaks or ring shadows, while dilated air bronchi may produce gloved finger shadows. So if there are dilated air filled bronchi, or dilated bronchi, first is dilated bronchi can give rise to tram line appearance. Dilated bronchi give rise to tram line shadows, while dilated air filled bronchi may produce the gloved finger shadows. Bronchiectasis is a chronic necrotizing infection of the bronchi and bronchioles, which leads to the abnormal and permanent dilatation of the airways. So it is chronic necrotizing infection of the bronchi and bronchioles, which leads to the abnormal permanent dilatation of the airways. So how will you describe this x-ray? You will say, this is a PA view of the chest x-ray showing multiple ring shadows at both the lower zones, multiple ring shadows at both the lower zones, more on the left as compared to the right. The areas of haziness and fibrosis is seen at the lung bases. There is a big bulla seen at the right apex, right cost of angle is blunted. There is no mediastinal shift. So I will again repeat, how will you describe X-ray of bronchiectasis? You will say this is a PA view of the chest X-ray. You will say this is a PA view of the chest X-ray, showing multiple ring shadows at the bases, at the lower zones, more on the right as compared to the left. Areas of haziness or fibrosis seen in the bases also. There's a big bulle seen in the right apex. Right cost of phrenic angle is blunted. There is no mediastinal shift, no mediastinal shift. Other points are within normal limit. Then dilated bronchi give rise to the tramline shadows or ring shadows or linear shadows. Dilated bronchi will give rise to the tramline shadows, ring shadows or linear shadows. While the dilated air-filled bronchi may produce cloud finger shadows. Dilated air-filled will produce the cloud finger shadows. So what is your conclusion? Now you will draw the conclusion of this chest X-ray. You will say this is bronchiectasis bilateral and basal. This is bronchiectasis bilateral and basal. Bilateral and basal bronchiectasis. Common site for bronchiectasis is the left lower lobe and the lingula. So these are the common site. This is left lower lobe and this is the lingula. So these are the common sites for bronchiectasis, left lower lobe and the lingula. Then questions come, how bronchiectasis patient presents? How does this patient presents to us? So there is a common presentation of cough with perfuse and often voided expectoration of the sputum, usually more marked in the morning after waking from the sleep. The patient may have hemoptysis, breathlessness, and features due to secondary infection may be associated. On examination, there is clubbing and coarse crepitations, which are mostly found on the back of the chest, that is the base of the lung, and may reduce or disappear after coughing. So examination asks, how does the patient have bronchiectasis present to you? You will say the patient is present with cough and perfused, often voided expectoration of the sputum. Cough with expectoration, which is more marked in the morning while awakening from the sleep. The patient may have hemoptysis and breathlessness. Features due to secondary infection may be associated. On examination, there is clubbing and coarse crepitations, which may be found on the back of the chest and may reduce or disappear after coughing. So this is how the patient of bronchiectasis presents. Then examiner can ask question, what is dry bronchiectasis or bronchiectasis sicca? So this is another question, what is bronchiectasis sicca or what is dry bronchiectasis? The examiner can ask. Then you will say it is also known as dry bronchiectasis. Here the apices of the lungs are affected, post tubercular bronchiectasis, in contrast to the bases, and the patient will have minimum or no sputum production, dry cough as a result of easy drainage. Hemoptysis may be the only symptoms. So it is also called as dry bronchiectasis. Here the apices are affected. Apices of the lungs are affected. Apices of the lungs are affected. Post tuberculosis, mostly post TB. Here the apices are affected, and the in contrast to the bases, and the patient will have very minimum or no sputum production. So what is bronchiectasis sicca? It is a dry bronchiectasis. Here the apices of the lungs are affected, mostly seen post tubercular patient, and there is minimum or no sputum production or minimum production of sputum. So there is dry cough. Hemoptysis may be the only symptoms in such cases. That is the bronchiectasis sicca. Then examiner can ask question, what is pseudo bronchiectasis? What is pseudo bronchiectasis? What is pseudobronchiectasis? So you will say it is a bronchographic abnormality resulting from the atelectasis or tracheobronchitis with ulceration in the bronchial mucosa, which mimic the cylindrical bronchiectasis. Re-expansion of the collapsed lung and healing of the bronchial mucosa make the condition reversible, and thus it is known as pseudobronchiectasis. So it is basically a bronchographic abnormality resulting from the atelectasis and tracheobronchitis with ulceration in the bronchial mucosa, which mimic the cylindrical bronchiectasis. So it is the broncho ग्राफिक, इट इज ब्रोंकोग्राफिक एबनॉर्मेलिटी एंड इट रिजल्ट्स फ्रॉम एटेलेक्टेसिस, इट रिजल्ट्स फ्रॉम एटेलेक्टेसिस एटेलेक्टेसिस एंड ट्रेकियोब्रोंकाइटिस, इट रिजल्ट फ्रॉम द एटेलेक्टेसिस एंड ट्रेकियोब्रोंकाइटिस विथ अल्सरेशन इन द ब्रोंकियल म्यूकोजा विच मिमिक, इट मिमिक्स द, इट मिमिक्स द सिलिंड्रिकल सिलिंड्रिकल ब्रोंकेक्टेसिस, इट मिमिक्स द सिलिंड्रिकल ब्रोंकेक्टेसिस. So what is pseudobronchiectasis? So it is basically a bronchographic abnormality resulting from the atelectasis and tracheobronchitis with ulceration in the bronchial mucosa which mimic the cylindrical bronchiectasis. So when there occurs the re-expansion of the collapsed lung and the healing of the bronchial mucosa, the condition is reversible and thus it is known as the pseudobronchiectasis. So what is pseudobronchiectasis? It is a bronchographic abnormality. Underline this. It is a bronchographic abnormality. It is a bronchographic abnormality. It is a bronchographic abnormality. So then another question. What is middle lobe? Describe middle lobe bronchiectasis. Describe middle lobe bronchiectasis. Describe middle lobe bronchiectasis. The examiner can ask you, will you describe the middle lobe bronchiectasis? Then you will say, yes sir, I can describe the middle lobe bronchiectasis. So what is middle lobe bronchiectasis? You will say when the middle lobe bronchus is obstructed by tuberculous lymph nodes sequel to primary pulmonary tuberculosis, a post obstructive bronchiectasis formed, which is known as the middle lobe bronchiectasis or middle lobe syndrome. This is a variety of post obstructive bronchiectasis. So what is middle lobe bronchiectasis? You will say when the middle lobe bronchus is obstructed by TB lymph node, is obstructed by tuberculous lymph node. When the middle lobe bronchus is obstructed by tubercular lymph node, which is due to the sequel to primary pulmonary tuberculosis, a post obstructive bronchiectasis is formed. And it is known as middle lobe bronchiectasis or middle lobe syndrome. It is a variety of post obstructive bronchiectasis. So what is middle lobe bronchiectasis? When the middle lobe bronchus is obstructed by tubercular lymph node, there occurs the formation of post obstructive bronchiectasis and is also known as the middle lobe bronchiectasis or middle lobe syndrome. It is a variety of post obstructive bronchiectasis. Then examiner can ask one more question. What is Kata-Gunnar syndrome? What is Kata-Gunnar syndrome? Kata-Gunnar syndrome. Another question, very important. What is Kata-Gunnar syndrome? So can you describe what is Kata-Gunnar syndrome? The examiner can ask like this. Then you will say this is also known as immotile cilia syndrome. The syndrome is the triad of bronchiectasis, dextrocardia and recurrent sinusitis. There is bronchiectasis, dextrocardia and recurrent sinusitis associated with infertility in males. Kata-Gunnar syndrome is a variety of primary ciliary dyskinesia where there is immotility of the cilia with abnormal mucus production and is present in the respiratory tract epithelium and the sperm. So it is named after the M. Kata-Gunnar was a Swiss physician. So Kata-Gunnar syndrome is also known as immotile cilia syndrome. There is a triad for Kata-Gunnar syndrome and that triad is bronchiectasis with dextrocardia with recurrent sinusitis, which is associated with infertility in males. So it is also known as the immotile cilia syndrome. It is characterized by bronchiectasis, dextrocardia, and recurrent sinusitis. recurrent sinusitis. You can remember it as BDS, VDS, bronchiectasis, dextrocardia, sinusitis, which is recurrent sinusitis. So it is a variety of primary ciliary dyskinesia. Then comes the question, what are the pathological types of bronchiectasis? You know, what are the pathological types of bronchiectasis? You know, then you will say, first is the cylindrical or fusiform bronchiectasis. There is uniform dilatation of the bronchi. Then there is varicose bronchiectasis. There is beaded pattern of the dilated bronchi. Then there is sacular bronchiectasis. Ballooned or cystic bronchi is called as the sacular bronchiectasis. So the pathology types, we have the cylindrical or fusiform. Cylindrical or fusiform. Then we have the varicose, which is beaded form. Varicose, beaded forms, beaded pattern of the dilated bronchi. Cylindrical is uniform dilatation. It is beaded form of beaded pattern of dilated bronchi. And lastly, we have the sacular cystic dilatation or ballooned dilatation. Ballooned or cystical bronchi is sacular bronchiectasis. Sacular bronchiectasis. This classification, the Riddle's classification, is based on the bronchographic appearance. Then the classification after that, hemoptysis in bronchiectasis. Why there is hemoptysis in bronchiectasis? Hemoptysis in bronchiectasis is due to the hypertrophy of the bronchial wall, friable mucosa of the bronchial wall, sloughing out of the mucosa and opening of the capillaries resulting in bleeding. So why there is bleeding? Because of the hypertrophy of the bronchial wall. There is hypertrophy of bronchial wall that leads to the friable mucosa, hypertrophy of the bronchial wall, friable mucosa, sloughing of the mucosa, sloughing out of mucosa, exposing the capillaries, opening the capillaries, and there is bleeding. So there is hypertrophy of the bronchial wall, friable mucosa, sloughing out of the mucosa, opening the capillaries, and bleeding. So this is how the bleeding occurs in bronchiectasis. Then can you outline the management of bronchiectasis? Outline the management of bronchiectasis. Then you will say antibiotics we will give for infection control, postural drainage. A position is adopted where the lobe to be drained remains uppermost. This is to be continued for 20 minutes once or twice daily in empty stomach. Gentle percussion over the front and the back of the chest with cupped hands helps dislodgement of the sputum. That is it is the chest physiotherapy. Then bronchodilators, mucolytics as and when necessary, inhaled or oral corticosteroids may be helpful. Bronchoscopic aspiration of the inspissated sputum is rarely needed. Surgery, that is lobectomy, is localized and unilateral lesion. If there is localized and unilateral lesion in young adults less than 40 years, we go for the lobectomy who are unresponsive to the medical treatment. Also in recurrent hemoptysis pneumonias. Heart lung transplantation is performed in bilateral extensive disease and general care in the form of diet correction of the anemia is needed. So for the management, you will give the antibiotics. For infection control, you will give the antibiotics. Then you will give the postural drainage. Postural drainage, the part to be drained remains uppermost and this has to be carried for 20 minutes. Postural drainage, where you can also do the chest physiotherapy with the on the front and the back of the chest with cupped hands helps in the dislodgement of the sputum. Then you can also give the bronchodilators, mucolytics as and when necessary. You will give bronchodilators, mucolytics, and sometimes steroids, oral or inhaled steroids. You will give as and when necessary. Bronchoscopic aspiration is rarely needed. Then fourth is surgery. You will go do in surgery if localized or failed medical therapy and the age is young, less than 40 years, you will go for this surgery. Then heart lung transplantation is performed in bilateral extensive disease. Then general care in the form of diet, nutritious diet, correction of anemia is needed. What are the complications of bronchiectasis? The examiner can ask, what are the complications of bronchiectasis? Then you will say pneumonia, pleurisy, pleural effusion, lung abscess, brain abscess, core pulmonary, respiratory failure, amyloidosis. So these are the various complications of bronchiectasis. So what are the complications? Pneumonias ho sakte hain patient ko. Patient can suffer from pneumonias, pleurisy, pleural effusions, lung abscess, brain abscess, core pulmonale, respiratory failure, amyloidosis. So these are the various complication of bronchiectasis. We'll repeat again so that you can understand or revise it better. So the complication of bronchiectasis causes pneumonia, pleurisy, pleural effusions, lung abscess, brain abscess, core pulmonary, respiratory failure, and amyloidosis. This is amyloidosis. So these are the complications of the bronchiectasis. Now the examiner can ask, how will you confirm your diagnosis of bronchiectasis? Then you will say, diagnosis can be made with certainty by bronchography. It was old procedure, but now HRCT investigation, HRCT, high resolution CT scan, is definitive and preferred investigation. This is the investigation of choice for bronchiectasis, HRCT, high resolution CT scan. Then the examiner can ask, what are the causes of honeycombing in the lung? Differential diagnosis of honeycombing in the lung. What are the differential diagnosis of honeycombing in the lung? Then X-ray picture in honeycombing shows. Then you will say, normally what is honeycombing? Honeycombing is the X-ray picture in honeycombing shows multiple air containing cyst like shadows. So you will say, honeycombing means multiple air containing cyst like shadows. Multiple air containing cyst like shadows. Multiple air containing cyst like shadows or ring shadows measuring. It is also called as cyst like shadows. Air containing cyst like shadows or ring shadows. Or ring shadows, which is about 0.5 to 2 cm in diameter. 0.5 to 2 centimeter in diameter, mimicking the bunch of grapes. These shadows are best visualized on high resolution CT scan, and these honeycombing or air containing cyst like ring shadows are seen in multiple conditions like bronchiectasis. Then you can also found in fibrosing alveolitis, systemic sclerosis, systemic lupus erythematosus, rheumatoid arthritis. Then honeycombing you can also see in cystic fibrosis, tuberous sclerosis, histiocytosis X. Then this honeycombing you also found in pneumoconiosis, sarcoidosis. Then extrinsic allergic alveolitis. First we discussed the fibrosing alveolitis. Now I am telling the extrinsic allergic alveolitis. Then after the use of drugs, like drugs can cause honeycombing like busulfan, nitrofurantoin, bleomycin, melphalan. So what are the causes of honeycombing? This is very, very important. You have to cram this question. What are the causes of honeycombing on chest X-ray, and what is honeycombing? So honeycombing are basically the multiple air containing, it is not single, it is multiple air containing cyst-like lesions, multiple air-containing cyst-like shadows or ring shadows having a diameter of 0.5 to 2 cm air containing cyst like shadows or ring shadows have 0.5 to 2 cm in diameter that is seen in various conditions. Like you can find the honeycombing in bronchiectasis, you can find the honeycombing in fibrosing alveolitis, you can find the honeycombing in systemic sclerosis, tuberous sclerosis, systemic lupus erythematosus, rheumatoid arthritis, histiocytosis, sarcoidosis, then cystic fibrosis, you will find the pneumoconiosis, extrinsic allergic alveolitis. So two types of alveolitis, one is fibrosing alveolitis, then extrinsic allergic alveolitis, then drugs like busulfan, nitrofurantoin, bleomycin, melphalan. So these are the causes of honeycombing on chest x-ray. Then the question can come, why the right costophrenic angle is blunted in the chest x-ray? So we have seen it. Then we will say it may be due to mild pleural reaction developed as a result of small collection of the fluid. So you will say it is a mild pleural reaction. Mild pleural reaction. That is why the right costophrenic angle is blunted. It may be due to mild pleural reaction developed as a result of small collection of the fluid. Then describe the three layer sputum in bronchiectasis. The question can come, describe the three layered sputum in bronchiectasis. So how will you describe? You will say, when the copious and foetid sputum from a bronchiectasis patient is collected in a conical glass, when the sputum from a bronchiectasis patient, what type of sputum? The copious and foetid sputum of a bronchiectasis patient is collected in a conical glass, it separates into three layers arbitrarily if allowed to stand for some time. And the layers are, so when you bronchiectasis patient, you take their sputum which is copious and foetid and you allowed it to stand for a conical glass for some time, it is arbitrarily divided into three layers. The three layers are, the uppermost layer is the mucoid layer. Uppermost layer is the mucoid layer. Middle layer is the mucopurulent layer. Mucopurulent layer. And the lower layer is the purulent layer. Purulent layer. So in the bottom you get the purulent layer, then in the middle layer you get the purulent as well as the mucoid, mucopurulent, and in the topmost you will get the mucoid layer. So this type of sputum is seen in bronchiectasis, mucoid, mucopurulent, purulent. So mucoid layer is basically contains the frothing, it contains the froth, mucoid layer. While mucopurulent contains the liquid and thick sputum, liquid and thick sputum, it contains the liquid and thick sputum. And the lowermost purulent layer contains the heavier particles, it contains the heavier particles, like it contains the epithelial debris, it contains the bacteria, it contains the bacteria, pus cell, blood clots. So this is the three layered sputum of the patient of a bronchiectasis. It forms the three layer, the upper layer, middle layer and the lower layer. The upper layer is basically the froth and the middle layer is basically the liquid and thick sputum, and the lowermost layer contains the heavy particles like epithelial debris, bacteria, pus cells, clots, all those things is in the lowermost layer, which is purulent. So this is about the bronchiectasis.